It's been over a month now since Sony's confirmed that a successor to the PlayStation Virtual Reality headset is coming. We don't know when it's coming or even what it will be called, but we know it's happening. We've seen the new controllers first, and as the weeks go by, we're even starting to see games being confirmed to release on us. Dev kits are about to roll out, if they haven't already, so the ball is rolling in that regard. For all of us virtual reality fans on PlayStation, it's all been a sigh of relief. It seems that the PSVR has performed well enough that Sony are saying, okay, this is a good start. We see something here. Let's improve the hardware and give it another go. This is something that nobody was really sure they would do. After all, PSVR sold more headsets than any of its competitors, but that's still only somewhere between 5 and 6 million units. Some people would compare that to console sales and see it as a small amount. Well, personally, I don't think that's the very best metric to use. But that raises the question then. What does the PSVR successor need to do to be successful? And if it doesn't achieve those goals, whatever they may be, will this be the last VR headset we see from Sony? This question is going to be open-ended. I don't have the answers because, of course, I'm not running the show over at Sony. However, I still think it's worth talking about, speculating, so let's talk about it. Before I do get started, please consider hitting that subscribe button, the bell, notification, all that usual YouTube shite. I'm very sorry to say it, so I just have to do it, so it has to be said, to help this channel grow, if you like this content. With that out of the way, the idea for this video came to me thanks to this article over at Upload Viewer by David Heaney. The article talks about the sales performance of the Oculus Quest 2, where Facebook revealed that its sales have surpassed all previous Oculus headsets combined, which seems like a very impressive statistic to pull out, and it seems like a very encouraging sign for the future of the medium. Now, I'm not saying it's not either of those things, but with Facebook not giving any units, very similar to Xbox, they do not tell you how many have actually been sold in hard figures. It's hard for me to get excited about stuff like this because I just don't know what that is in terms of actual hard numbers. Yes, it's better than the previous headsets, but what did the previous headsets actually sell? A few hundred thousand? Couple of million? I don't know. Nobody knows outside of Facebook. That brought me back to PSVR. The last official update we got from Sony on PSVR sales was 5 million units sold. Now, this was all the way back in January 2020, so over a year ago. It seems like the headset hasn't managed to cross the 6 million sold mark yet, so unless Sony no longer feels the need to give an update after every million sold, then I think it's safe to say its sales have slowed considerably. So for argument's sake, let's say the PSVR has sold something like 5.5 million units as of today. Now, let's ask ourselves, when Sony first decided they were going into the virtual reality game, back in the Project Morpheus days, what were Sony's goals for the headset? Were they hoping for a specific number of units sold throughout its lifetime? Or maybe their preferred metric was a certain percentage of PS4 users. Perhaps it was just their way of dipping their toes in the water to get a feel for that market. We will, of course, never know unless Sony reveal it themselves. What we do know, however, is that back when the PSVR had confirmed to sell 1 or 2 million, Sony themselves did state that they were not comfortable being the market leader. We also know that they used existing technology in the form of light tracking and move controllers instead of really going all out and creating controllers better suited to virtual reality as well as a better tracking system. They didn't even put analog sticks on the move controllers, for Christ's sake. So when we put all that together, it starts to paint a picture. Picture of a company who were intrigued by virtual reality, but who were also very wary of it. They didn't want to be left behind in case it was the next Nintendo Wii, but they also weren't willing to go balls deep and fully commit to the platform. Whatever the case, it seems the PSVR headset performed well enough for Sony to justify giving us another shot for the PS5. This time, Sony are pulling up their pants, giving us proper virtual reality controllers with all sorts of bells and whistles. They've sorted out their ancient tracking solution, and they've made the setup process much more user-friendly by reducing it down to just plugging in one single cord. And while we don't have much details on the actual headset itself, it's safe to say it'll be a big improvement over what we currently have, with a wider field of view and presumably a higher resolution display. This all raises the question of price, but that's a topic for another day, I think. You can be sure that development for the PSVR's successor has been much more expanded on compared to the original for PlayStation, and so it only makes logical sense that Sony's expectations in terms of the sales for the successor will also be expanded upon. If the successor releases and sells 5.5 million units in its lifetime, that would certainly be seen as a failure by Sony, you would imagine. And then it might be time for Sony to end their virtual reality affair, just like they dipped out of the handheld markets right after the Vita failed. Now that is a bleak scenario, but how do we avoid it? What does the PSVR's successor need to do in order to ensure that it itself will have a successor? Sales, of course, is the obvious answer. Sony is a for-profit business at the end of the day, but what's the number it needs to hit? Is anything less than breaking into the mainstream going to be a failure for Sony? Is it too early to expect a VR headset to break into the mainstream? What even constitutes mainstream in this context anyway? Is it 20 million? 40 million? 100 million? What other factors are there to consider? Will the fact that Xbox, PlayStation's main rival, currently has no plan to support VR give Sony incentive to keep supporting it themselves? Possibly. After all, it sure would be a nice feather in Sony's hat to say, hey look, we have Half-Life Alyx as a console exclusive, to say nothing of what other titles may come. Now, that is just an example. Half-Life Alyx has not been confirmed, although I would say there's a very good chance of it happening. So, with all that being said, PlayStation's next virtual reality headset feels yet again like a leap of faith from Sony. This isn't like going from PS1 to PS2, where PS2 just made logical sense. This next headset is going to be another gamble for Sony, one where they have to be very careful with how they present this product. It has to be user-friendly enough, it has to be desirable, it has to have the games, and it has to be priced correctly. And those are just the factors within Sony's own control. Outside of that, maybe motion sickness will still be too big of an issue for it to truly go mainstream, yes. Or perhaps the coronavirus will get people more interested in VR than ever before and be a huge boon for the PSVR 2, or whatever it's going to be called. We'll have to wait and see if this gamble will pay off. I sure hope it will. That is it for this video, lads and ladies. Before I end the video, let me thank the following Patreon supporters whose names are on the screen as I speak. Thanks to their generosity, they're helping keep this channel going and helping me make more videos like this. In particular, let me give a huge shout out to the following top tier Patreon supporters: Pete Hawkins, Crumb, Tradition, Chopped517, Daniel the Pumpkin Patch Kid, and Columbus Thomas III. Thank you very much for that support. Lads, it is very much appreciated. If you'd like to help me out over on Patreon, you can do so. The link to that will be in the description below. If not, I'll be happy with just the likes, subscribe, dinging the bell, all that usual YouTube shite. And of course, let me know your thoughts and opinions on all of this stuff in the comments below. Finally, let me thank Decepticon for letting me use his music in all of my videos. Thank you very much, Decepticon. His latest album just came out very recently. You should look that up. Link to that will be in the description as well. I'll see you in the next one, lads and ladies. Please stay nice and slippery, wet, moist.
Petrifying pumpkin.